LBR LBO Debrief.
Good morning. Thanks very much for this opportunity. Inconsistency is what we've got used to, but you know, given all the experience we've had in Sri Lanka, we may possibly have success in the new US regime, understanding them in the future. Businesses and even businesses like us, maybe we'll understand them better than they can understand themselves. So in terms of the Sri Lankan economy and the outlook, I'd like to organize the presentation in this way. First, there's a lot of complexity with economics for most people, lots of different things being talked about. So I'm going to try to simplify it to first talk about what we think matters and what doesn't matter in terms of understanding the economy as it relates to most businesses. For us, understanding the Sri Lankan economy is understanding what we call the rates LKR cycle in Sri Lanka. So I will outline that and then outline why in our base case for 2017, we think that cycle is actually turning positive. That's our base case. But despite that, our alternative scenarios are quite adverse, and essentially our message is that it's as important to worry about the negatives despite the fact that the base is positive. And I'll sort of explain why we are worried on what we call the outlier scenarios, why they occur and why we are worried about it. And finally, in terms of actionable, what can you do with all this? In terms of the different views we will give you in terms of the LKR rates, demand conditions in Sri Lanka, what is the takeaways? What can you do with this in terms of your business? What matters and what doesn't? So economics, actually even for me sometimes, often, gets very confusing. There's a lot of different things that come out in the economy. This is a kind of humorous take on how economists sort of the debate continues this way, that way. A lot of numbers coming out. And the headlines. We have a lot of so-called economic discussions, debates, different columnists in the papers, different opinions, and that you can get swamped by a lot of economic debate in the papers. So this is what businesses have to deal with. Try to make sense of this. What does it mean in terms of your business? So economics can be used from different perspectives. You can use it to understand policies. But what we try to do, and what I'm very much trying to do here, is try to figure out what would matter to y'all as a business in terms of some of the key things that will matter to the business next year. What can you do for next year? So for us, that comes down to, I mean, there can be more things than this, but for us, for a broad section of all of y'all, I would say what many of y'all would want to know is, what is going to happen to interest rates next year? You know, how do we position our financials in terms of interest rates? What is the outlook for the LKR? Where is the rupee going to go in terms of exports, imports? How do you position things? And what's the consumer going to do? If you are selling to the domestic market, how are conditions for the consumer going to do? The previous presentations obviously talked about the global, the different economies where the US. So if you're an exporter, hopefully that gave you an idea which economies are going to see better conditions next year. So I'm actually focusing in terms of the outlook for the domestic economy and essentially a view on these three things. Because if I try to go beyond this into all the other areas, it can become very complex. So what we are going to do here is look at the developments related to these variables, okay? And what I don't like to do and what is not relevant to these particular variables, come up with a wish list about the policies what the government should do in the long term. You know, that is a favorite topic of debate. It is useful in some parts, but in terms of figuring out what's going to happen to next year, I don't think it's particularly useful because, the government will take a wish list, make it more convoluted and come up with something very different which it never implements in the first place. So I really don't spend time with policy wish lists, but rather figure out what matters. So in terms of our views, these are some of the key areas we look at in terms of how our view is formed. I will talk about where these things are moving. So actually quite critical for us is some of the global developments. So what is happening in other currencies, competitor currencies? What is happening in terms of global fund flows to emerging markets? What's happening to our borrowing costs? We keep refinancing a lot of debt. What is happening in terms of ability and the cost of such borrowing? Varied trends in money supply. Reserves, you will see how important we consider reserves and the number of reserves. The repayment schedule. So these are some of the key variables we look at. What we don't look at in terms of the economy, and since, I mean, in terms of focusing, it's an 80-20 rule. We focus on the 20% that in fact impacts 80%, and there's a lot of stuff we don't focus on, and which I will not go into in this presentation. We don't look at GDP growth. Sri Lankan GDP numbers are pretty meaningless to us. We don't look at data like unemployment. As I said, all these policy statements that come out that never get implemented or get completely contradicted in another policy statement, I mean, it's noise. It doesn't help us. Trade agreements. Lakshman, again, to me, this government working on trade agreements, it's a lot of noise. I don't know what's going to come out of it. It doesn't, it's going to just move here and there. Useful in terms of lobbying them, but I don't spend much time figuring those out. And the different social indicators, because again, these are useful things, but not in terms of exactly what we are trying to focus on, and particularly the kind of data that the government gives that often are used. So to understand the Sri Lankan economy, we start with what we call the rates and the rupee cycle for the Sri Lankan economy. So as you are kind of probably very familiar with, every, I don't know, 4 or 5 years, we go through an economic shock of sorts. You know, suddenly after a period of a stable rupee, very low interest rates, suddenly you have a year where interest rates jump 500 basis points, you know, something like 7 to 12%. These are unprecedented. We've got used to this, but in any other country, these are, I mean, even emerging economies, this is not normal that, you know, you have these 7 to 12% fluctuations within a year or two. That's not a kind of normal thing. We have got used to it, but it is not normal. That is the Sri Lankan economic cycle. Rupee suddenly depreciating, anything from 10 to 20% within a year after a period of stability. Currency volatility is more normal in other countries, but again, this happening on a regular cycle is very, very, I mean, I'm sure there are a few other countries like that, but it is a very Sri Lankan thing, and almost in a sense predictable. So let me explain this cycle. Essentially, we start off with the central bank having loose monetary policy, which is low interest rates. The government, usually because of some election-related thing, massively boosting government expenditure. That leads to a big jump in consumption imports, and low interest rates also lead into foreign capital moving out. And essentially, a pressure on the BOP and currency. Always there is some global volatility at some point in the year. Added to it is increasingly a debt repayment schedule. So this causes an economic shock. We get stuck. This is what happens. I'll show you how it's happened over time. And then after a certain point, after, you know, a couple of months of the government saying, no, we are fine, we're absolutely fine. We don't need the IMF. We don't need anyone. IMF doesn't know what they're doing. They go to the IMF. And the IMF then says, adjust your rates, adjust the currency, you know. That happens. And then they say, increase taxes, have a tighter fiscal thing. So all that increased government expenditure, higher budget deficit, bring it back down. That happens. Then the demand in the economy really collapses. Less imports. Overall confidence is there. Foreign investors are very positive. The IMF is with you. And then we are back to a stage of more stable currency and interest rates. And then again, in another couple of years, this happens. So it just keeps going round and round. That's it. I mean, that's it. I mean, you know, give or take a couple of years, it's, I can probably give you a 30-year prediction here. You know, we'll have a couple of these cycles. So, and the easiest way to understand whether we are getting into this cycle or not, just one number, I mean, to simplify everything, I mean, just one number to look at, keep a track of Sri Lankan reserve number. Because if the Sri Lankan reserve number starts falling dramatically, we are going to get into trouble. First, they start defending it, you know, the central bank just absolutely starts defending, saying there is no problem, we've busted $1 billion in reserves, that's fine, you know, no problem, we are going to get money from here, there, this is temporarily, and then we, you know, we are in a shock, and then they are back with the IMF. So here, it's quite easy, $2 billion, so anything beyond $2 billion, if it falls, we are in trouble. Simple. That's it. I mean, it's like, actually, it's 70% of my job just following this, actually. And that's just one number to follow. And what happens with this is, with those reserves, I mean, these are exactly the same periods, sorry. These periods, same periods, I'll show what happens to LKR. LKR, up 9% in the 2008 shock, 21% in 2011, and 13% so far in the 2015 shock. Interest rates. I mean, this is massive. This volatility you're seeing with interest rates, it's pretty unprecedented, you know? 600 basis points, 500 basis points, over 700 basis points over a longer period in 2007 with the shock. Okay, so the reserves drop, you're heading for massively high interest rates, the LKR. So just predict where reserves are going, you are most of the way there. Actually, you don't need to even predict it too much because, you know, the first billion, they bust up and, you know, and say everything is fine without the adjustment happening. So this really helps you, reserves and the rates and the LKR cycle. After a little bit of bad news that you have to probably deal with this for every 5 years for the next 20 years, the good news is our base case is that the rates LKR cycle is now turning positive. Like I said, for that, the easy thing is, are we talking to the IMF? You know, if we start talking to the IMF and start agreeing that the IMF is a good idea, then, you know, things are going to get good in terms of interest rates and the LKR. It's quite different in terms of demand. The alternate, when the rates and LKR get stable, your demand conditions actually get worse. This was a photo taken about, I think, I don't know, about 8 months ago or whatever, when they were saying, no, we don't really need the IMF or whatever, but they were having talks. And I think the picture really captures, you used to see this, you know, hey, we are well on track to the positive cycle somewhere down the line. It's going to take some time, denial, you know, that whole cycle of first you disagree and then you despair and then you get afraid and finally you accept. So this was the start of the cycle and now we are well in tune with the IMF. The IMF asks us, you gone and busted your budget, now sort that out. And we do that. We actually do that. We mess up the budget deficit, the government overspends, and then they come back and tax you like crazy. They don't know exactly the best way to tax, but trust me, because the IMF is on board, they are going to tax. So I know there's a lot of confusion about the budget proposals. The next panel will have to deal with that. But they are. I mean, it's very clear. For me, the message in this budget, and even this year, is that they are very, very, whether or not it's good for overall economic activity, different sectors, they are going to get the budget back on track. So this is also very important in terms of the rate cycle, this fiscal deficit coming down. So actually this year itself, forget next year, our deficit number is, I mean, a big drop from the 7.4%. We've been talking about a big deficit earlier. It's actually coming down a lot this year and expected, even in our numbers, going down to 5%, which is quite a very low, pretty low number in a Sri Lankan context. Another actually very important thing in terms of the Sri Lankan economic cycle is the new governor. I think in terms of, again, we have a lot of borrowing to do and retaining confidence of international markets is very important. And the new governor's credibility and his approach is actually very, very important for the economy. That matters. And in terms of the kind of messaging he's giving out, it really helps us. So again, you know, this is not a numbers thing. These things matter. In terms of actually what a central bank can do, private sector credit growth has been too high relative to the structure of our economy. And that has been a factor that in the end leads to balance of payments leakages of varied sorts. So our private sector credit growth has been running at about 25%. It's still very high, and this is also quite important to monitor, but our expectation is this will, I mean, it takes time from the point interest rates go up for private sector credit growth to reduce. So our expectation is, I mean, even this time, today's morning's release said that the year-on-year growth rate had reduced from 27 to about 25, and our expectation is it would reduce further and get to more stable levels. And the overall improvement of these economic conditions, the governor's the fiscal conditions, the governor's appointments reflects in the fact that we have a lot of debt coming up and ability to refinance it at reasonable rates is very important. It also, the rates itself express ability to go to markets. And from the beginning of this year to now, rates, borrowing rates, these are sovereign bonds, have actually fallen about 150 basis points or so. So as of February, when things are looking quite bleak, rates were, some of these rates were at about 8%. Now it's back down to about 5%. So significant reduction in sovereign yields. Again, the low point this year was around February, but foreign investors have been, there's a big decline last year and in the first part of this year as well, foreign holdings. Foreign holdings, in fact, were as high as 500 billion rupees in local treasuries and bonds, and this is absolutely critical to balance of payments support. It fell to 220. We were on upward trend up to about October. Okay, now this coming down again, a little bit of a worry factor here. But overall, the trend so far this year, from March onwards, has been quite positive. So that's the good news. So when we talk about our views, those are the reasons our base case is positive. But there are things we worry about, not Sri Lanka related, and why we are what we call vigilant. You know, in 2015, from around April onwards, for about 1 year, we were giving very negative stories about the Sri Lankan economy. So this was a thing about the Sri Lankan economy we had. And I was really hoping to have a clear positive message for 2017. Absolutely hoping, because I don't know whether you've noticed this, economies always, we are worried, we are saying this, that, you know, they don't sound very positive. You know, and especially after, from April 2015, for 1 year going all negative, was really hoping to have a clear, unambiguous, positive message about things. You know, not just say the base case is positive, not to worry too much about other stuff. And actually, in April, we released a report talking about the positivity we saw for 2017. In September, we built on that in terms of having a view that the rupee would be more stable and, in fact, rates to fall. We built on that for our end 2017 view, which is still the view, but the message was very positive. I mean, you know, in terms of our equity outlook, we're telling people to buy into the stock market, all that. And then the US election happened. So before the election, I would have wanted a picture like this for myself. This is where I am right now in terms of the overall thing. Though we have a base case, it's a lot more uncertain base case. As Paulie has said, we are in a world of uncertainty. The only certain is uncertainty. I think the global geopolitical situation, even more than the economic numbers, are extremely uncertain for us right now. It's another image of post-election, trying to deal with things in markets. So why do these external developments matter so much? You know, why is it that suddenly changing that overall sense and mood? The most non-portfolio, so to speak, flows, the loan inflows, these are like the government to government money, the ADB monies to the government, that has been falling this year. The FDIs, which are minuscule, are falling. Quite a dramatic fall, actually, the first half of this year. So these numbers are falling. At the same time, our overall debt repayment schedule, I mean, this is one thing you would have seen about Sri Lanka's debt, our foreign debt repayment schedule has ballooned compared to what the situation was 4 years ago. It was not something we really had as a big factor in the cycle earlier, but this is now a factor in future cycles. Our current account deficit, which is the trade and remittances and all that, actually that situation is better, because what used to be a deficit of about 4.6 billion is now at about the 2 billion levels. The problem is our debt repayment schedule, which is about a billion, is now 4.6 billion. So with debt, it's quite a simple thing. If we can retain the confidence of the international investors, so when we are a sovereign loan or SLDB is maturing, if they're happy to give it back to us, refinance it, we keep going, we keep rolling over. As long as we keep rolling over, I mean, at some point there's going to be a problem, but usually rolling over is not a problem as long as you're keeping the confidence of international investors locally and global markets are stable. If global markets become unstable and people don't want to invest in emerging and front economies, given the level of debt repayments we have, we get into trouble. And the level of reserves we have, we get into trouble very, very easily if people are not willing to refinance this. So we come back to President-elect Trump, and why does he matter? The election and the market's reaction to that was quite surprising for a lot. First, the US market had a huge 5% fall, but after that has been doing really well. So the Make America Great is translating to the American old economy, stocks, expectations from the infrastructure spending being very positive. But emerging markets have actually seen a lot of down outflows after this, because of worries of protectionism, and in particularly the fact that US interest rates are rising, making US capital go up. I mean, what the previous speakers talked about. So there's been quite a sharp weakness in emerging market currencies, mirrored through in Sri Lanka. So this matters in terms of a portfolio flows. I think this has been touched upon, but just to give a idea how it can turn very bad, one is that overall, with the US being more attractive as an investment destination because of high interest rates, essentially not as an investment destination, simply the fact that US Treasuries, earlier US Treasuries giving virtually nothing, meant emerging markets were pretty attractive in terms of putting into our Treasury bonds and bills. So that's a big risk in terms of our Treasury bonds and bills money going out. Trade wars. President-elect Trump is talking about a protectionist situation, and if this leads to a global trade war situation, the geopolitics where China, the US, I mean, that could be a situation where nobody wants to invest anywhere. And emerging markets typically being seen as risky is where people will not want to put money in. Okay? And overall financial markets volatility. It's the US market has been positive, but people still consider the kind of policies that could happen could lead to sudden market reactions because of all the uncertainty. So all that could again move very badly for emerging markets, and emerging markets as in Sri Lanka as well. I can also give the other hand, so this is where economists get a little complicated. You can say it can be positive because we really don't know about President-elect Trump's policies. One is it could be possibly good for everyone. I mean, the trade, that infrastructure spending will boost US growth, a pro-business agenda. He is, after all, a Republican, which is seen as a pro-Republican agenda. Well, he's now a Republican. He used to be a Democrat. It always gets confusing. US and Russia getting together and taking action on global security threats and reduction in that. I mean, he's basically the very positive President-elect Trump scenario makes everything better for everyone, you know? And global growth is doing very well. So that's a possibility. When these big things happen, you don't know these geopolitical things. That's a possibility. I'm a bit skeptical of that. Another thing, which I'm more, I think probably more likely, is that end of the day, I mean, I think many people, conventional economists, a lot of the conventional wisdom is that the Trump presidency, his changing policies, for example, could possibly be seen very, very negatively. I mean, the US policy framework now seems a bit like the Sri Lankan policy framework. So the reason people avoid countries like Sri Lanka is because, or want a premium to invest in Sri Lanka, is because Sri Lanka is considered riskier. So for example, people could look at moving money from places like the US to emerging markets, because emerging markets, I think as Paul has said, it's time for them to step up and will be actually seen as grown-ups in the room, less risky. And that could lead to actually a change in the trend, money coming back to emerging markets. There's also situations, I mean, at the moment, all he's talked about is tariffs on China and Mexico. He hasn't specifically talked about other countries. So he puts a tariff on China alone. It could work out very positively on us, because China is obviously, for most exporters, the number one. I mean, if Chinese exports have massive tariffs going to the US, I can see a massive resurgence in manufacturing in all other countries, including Sri Lanka. So there are essentially the situation with President-elect Trump and the impact of Sri Lanka could be many, many ways. It's actually confusing. And this is important because our reserve situation, like I said, has been falling. This should be the trend upwards. But where this means in terms of fund flows and whether this continues to go up is where the question mark is. But the level of reserves, like I said, here we got 6 billion and 4.8 billion worth of outpayments in terms of repayments. Okay, what does this mean to you, President-elect Trump? positivism in our base case. Our key message is that you should stay vigilant given these outlier risks. That is our message. And what this means and how this means in terms of our views for 2017 ILKR is, like I said, we have a positive base that's got the highest probability. We have an outlier. Okay, this is going to probably, it has to be interpreted properly. Remember when interest rates went to about 20%? You know, we have an outlier possibility of about 10% that it could go that high if the negativism from Trump happens. We also have an outlier, 5% probability, that's one in every 20 years kind of probability, that rates could fall dramatically to 6%. That's if money comes back. Even in terms of the currency, there are outlier possibilities. The rupee can going as high as 190 or even appreciating beyond 140. Okay, those are not our base views. Okay, but what it says is this is a world of uncertainty. Our overall view is positive, but really bad things could happen in a lower probability scenario. So this is what it looks like in terms of our chart and the way we like to portray our views. This is the way we deal with uncertainty. And I will explain how that could translate from a business sense. So our base case in terms of the T-bill, and this translates to other interest rates, is with somewhere about over 10, could fall to anything in this range, somewhere like 9%. So quite a reasonable fall. But just keep in mind this outlier possibility that it could go to anything here, which is a huge jump from where we are right now. And what that could mean to the business. That's a 10%. So these are the probabilities. 10%, 30%, 45%, 5%. And this is where we are right now. And where I could go within that. This is the LKR. Again, outlier risk. It's only 10%. But massive depreciation is possible if there is a global event. The terms we call it is trumped up and trumped down to make it clear that this is largely external risk. It could be because of Europe, but like I said, these are things that are flowing through from, you know, the US election, I think, in some ways. So that, could give an idea of extreme outlier. But otherwise, I mean, our base case, so to speak, is a relatively positive situation, not much of a depreciation. But be mindful of the outliers. So that's our LKR interest rate view for Sri Lanka. Okay, so what's our GDP view? Someone in my team does a GDP forecast and a model, but they're here right now, but I actually don't even remember it most of the time. Okay, this is a number that I think it helps you in life. Focus on the important things. You know, we have limited room to think about things and give up on the rest. So GDP, in Sri Lankan GDP, for me, has been utterly useless. Okay? So just to give some idea of this, you know, they change the GDP number. They rebase the GDP number. Earlier, they were giving one set of numbers, and then for the same years, they went and gave another set. So in 2012, what used to be 9% was rebased to 6%. Then what was 7% became 3.4%. So these are completely, I mean, from the way most people interpret GDP, a 7.42% number and a 3.4% number. I mean, when people rebase GDP, it changes a little bit. 7 might become 6 or something. But these are completely different. I mean, if someone says GDP growth in Sri Lanka is going to be 3%, and then someone later says, no, but that also the same number in another base is 7%, it is very hard to interpret. And this actually helps understand because my clients used to spend time trying to understand, now my sales growth is this, government is saying GDP growth is this, how does it translate? And we had a lot of trouble explaining this to people that GDP is not useful, but after the rebase, it helped us. But doesn't prove that the new numbers are correct because 2012 was a period of a massive economic, quite a big economic shock. And we had actually this 9% would have been like the best growth, I mean, in history in Sri Lanka. So the new base also seems very suspicious. Then even with the new base, they revised these numbers. This is the first revision. They revised it three times. Final number for 2015, I think, comes out in 2017. But the first revision, within a few months, the 6% became a 4.4%. Some things that were negative became positive. So these are, again, quite big variances in a revision. So what's the number business uses in terms of forecasting? How would we assess? We give a forecast and whether we are correct or not, how do we assess? In fact, in 2012, we said we believe GDP growth is going to fall below 7%, significantly below 7%. The government kept releasing numbers that were well above it. We look wrong, but now we look right. So, I mean, this is really very difficult. So how do we use this in terms of numbers? My thing is, if it's too confusing, don't use it. So that's our approach with Sri Lankan GDP numbers. What we do is we use a concept, because most people want GDP to, how is my consumer? Is the consumer going to buy more this year or less more this year? So we use a broad term called domestic demand conditions. We are trying to work with some proxy variables to give actual number to what it would be. But for now, you know, it's just a sense of things. How will the consumer do next year? Now, though I said that base case for LKR and rates is stable, domestic demand conditions in almost all our scenarios is going to probably be worst. Okay, it's a very high probability thing. There's higher taxation, high interest rates, a rupee that has depreciated, that is going to take the toll on the consumer next year. First half in particular. So compared to what you saw this year and definitely compared to last year, which was a pretty good year for the consumer, next year is going to be bad. It's going to be a tough going if you're selling to the domestic consumer. So that's the message, rather than GDP. This is a sense of what we talk about, domestic demand condition. Getting back to rates and LKR, I know it would be nice if I could give you a one view, but we don't. I think that's inaccurate to think that I, at 100% probability, believe the rupee will be a specific number. That kind of certainty is not there in your forecast. But we've given you all kind of scenarios. You all have to do something as a business with this. What do you do? To me, the answer in this is, how do you feel and deal with risk? Your risk tolerance and where you all are positioned as a business, each one individually. Now, there's a concept called loss aversion for most people. What that is most people, let's take an investment, between doubling and halving your money or winning or losing ₹1 million, 50% probability of each. Most people will choose not to take that bet. Even if it's weighted 60-40 in terms of winning, they will not take it because people don't like the risk. Same thing in terms of business. If you have a business outcome where you can like significantly lose money or significantly get money, and even if it's weighted towards gaining money, you'd rather not take that because the risk of loss hurts more. Losing hurts more than the pain people feel when winning. And I find this even when I advise people, I tend to take the cautious approach because if my client loses money, that affects me more and I'd rather not that happen than the client loses out the opportunity of making money. But that again is individual and depends where you are positioned. But I come from a position that I believe most people are loss averse just as much as I am. So my takeaways from this, in a situation of such a lot of uncertainty, is that we spend more time, our base case is positive, but we urge most businesses we advise to spend as much time, your base case in terms of business planning, your financial planning with the LKR and rates, is on the positive. Rates are falling, LKR is stable. That can be your main plan. Then immediately put it through whatever sensitivities you have. How am I going to deal with it if the rupee goes to 190? What am I going to do if rates jump 8%? How does my business, can it survive this? Is it something I can tolerate? Is the level of debt I have too much or too little? How is my forex exposure? Because if it's a problem now, deal with it today. Because if the global situation becomes uncertainty and bad and there's sudden outflows from emerging markets, it's like the global financial crisis in 2008. Then you don't have time. Things are moving too fast. In terms of, for example, equity exposure, again, with a scenario like this, which is very wide band, even though the overall is positive, with those outlier risks being reasonable and there, I would be selling equity and get into cash, for example, in terms of portfolio positioning. And of course, get ready for worse domestic demand conditions. So like I said, our overall base case is positive for LKR and rates, negative in almost all scenarios for domestic demand conditions, but worry about the negative, the outliers, because businesses often forget those risks, and when those risks become important enough for us to talk about, I would suggest start preparing for them. So that is really our message, and I look forward to the questions that come up in the panel discussion. Thank you.
LBR LBO Debrief.